MIT students recently brought home the top prize in the Hyperloop pod competition to much media fanfare. It was such a big deal that the creator of the Hyperloop himself, Elon Musk, showed up to watch the fun. But what is a Hyperloop anyway?
You probably know about Elon Musk. If you don't, you should. He's been called a real-life Tony Stark. Originally, he made his fortune from selling PayPal to eBay for $1.5 billion in 2002. Now he's the CEO of both private space contractor SpaceX and electric car manufacturer Tesla. In 2013, Musk released plans for a new transportation technology that would cut San Francisco to LA commute times to 35 minutes. That's 1/12 of commutes today.
Enter Hyperloop, a pod and tube system that uses an extremely low pressure environment to attain speeds that would revolutionize modern transportation. Musk refers to this as the fifth mode of transit, being safer, faster, cheaper, immune to weather, and self-sustaining.
So planes, trains, cars, boats, Hyperloop.
Here's how Musk envisions it. There are three basic parts: capsule, tube, and propulsion mechanism. For the capsule, imagine a floating train. Musk proposes having 40 capsules with 28 passengers each. And in his drawings, they look a bit like the monorail at Disney World. Imagine these capsules in cylindrical steel tubes, raised 20 feet above the ground with supports every 100 feet or so. You may be inclined to imagine the Hyperloop as a giant version of the pneumatic tubes at banks, but that's not quite how it functions.
Ooh. It's sucky. Yes! That is marvelous how that...
Those systems use fans to constantly remove air for suction or blow air for propulsion. The reason that Hyperloop can't do this is because something as large or as fast as Hyperloop generates such insane amounts of friction that the fans would have to use enormous amounts of power just to overcome it.
You could theoretically remove all the air and have a total vacuum, but as Musk points out, that would be a huge pain, considering all the stops and places where leaks could occur.
The Hyperloop is supposed to be a combination of those two methods, using the acceleration method of the total vacuum model, but the low pressure environment of the bank tube. The problem with letting any air at all inside the tube, however, is that you run into something called the Kantrowitz limit. The Kantrowitz limit dictates the amount of space that has to remain around the capsule inside the tube before airflow is choked and the capsule runs into what is essentially a wall of air. The solution, according to Musk, is to put a compressor at the front of the capsule.
The compressor provides two benefits. The first is reducing pressure at the front of the capsule, artificially increasing airflow around the capsule. The other benefit is levitation. The Hyperloop doesn't need wheels because it uses linear induction motors along the sides of the Hyperloop for acceleration, sort of like those roller coasters that launch you at the start. So to reduce friction, the air collected at the front of the capsule is distributed along the underside of the capsule, hovercraft style, to suspend it in the tube. The fan powers itself, and the solar panels along the length of the Hyperloop power the motors, making a self-sustaining system. Essentially, Hyperloop is a solar-powered flying train in a tube with a special fan at the front.
After Musk released his plans in 2013, things get a bit more interesting. Too busy launching rockets and making electric cars, Musk turned towards the public to make his idea a reality. Two competing companies have emerged to undertake the challenge of creating the next step in modern transportation: Hyperloop Technologies and Hyperloop Transportation Technologies. These companies will be creating their own versions of a Hyperloop, inspired by, but independent of, Musk. Separately, SpaceX has begun hosting a series of Hyperloop pod competitions, where university teams prototype designs on a small scale. The most recent of these was at Texas A&M, where MIT took home the top prize. In summer 2016, the top teams will meet again, this time at a one-mile test track constructed adjacent to SpaceX's California facility.
So Isaac, when will you and I be able to ride the Hyperloop?
The goal for public use is 2020, but given such obstacles as getting government funding, property zoning, and the absence of necessary technology, it might be a while before you and I get to see one. Until then, we'll keep you updated. Hey, misbehaving, saving all my love for you.